You'd think the experts had the Grand Canyon all figured out, that they'd all agreed on how it was formed. Would it surprise you to learn that the Grand Canyon's origin story still confounds the experts to this day? As early as back in June 2000, there was a Grand Canyon symposium held where experts like geologists and hydrologists would meet and once and for all figure out how to overcome the consistent problems with all their previous theories. Today we're going to run through some of those theories and why they didn't work, and then I'm going to tell you about a theory proposed by the Electric Universe model of cosmology, a shoe that I believe you'll find fits much better. Now, one of the problems with the standard model of the Grand Canyon's formation is that the Colorado River, even before the Glen Canyon Dam stemmed its awesome desert floods, was never really big enough to explain the size of the canyon. And then you run into another major problem. Well, literally. The Colorado flows out of the Rockies to the west and runs smack into a raised plateau called the Kaibab Upwarp. That isn't the worst of it, though. The headwaters of the Colorado are at a lower elevation than the Kaibab is. Now, I don't know where you're from, but in my neck of the woods, water doesn't run uphill. And if it encountered an obstacle like a plateau, it goes around. The Colorado River, on the other hand, just goes right through. Experts offer that the river slowly cut its way in as the land rose around. Trouble is, the plateau was there a long time before the river was. I'm no Ralph Juergens, but that seems like a problem to me. Now let's talk about the 5.4 trillion cubic yards of missing material that was supposedly excavated from the canyon by the Colorado River. The symposium concluded in a report that all this missing material left little evidence in support of the original theory that a simple progression of water erosion formed the Grand Canyon we see today. Now that much we can agree on. And since the 1930s and 40s, geologists have been searching for a more reasonable explanation. They've offered up several since. One proposes the river changed direction, headed to the southeast, while another claims it must have flowed northeast instead. Trouble with both is that, once again, there's no river drainage to back them up. Another theorizes that the waters of the Colorado collected behind the Kaibab Upwarp Plateau until it overflowed and cut the canyon out with the resulting floodwaters. But again, the headwaters of the Colorado are at a lower elevation than the Upwarp, and I'm pretty sure that isn't how water works. One of the newer theories proposes the collapse of the Red Wall Aquifer after water eroded the karst and maybe some tectonic movement to set it off. They theorize this happened back when the Rocky Mountains were newly formed. It's a decent argument, and sinkholes that form from water eating away the karst are common enough. Trouble is, the world's largest sinkhole is the Shaoxi Tianqing in China. It can hold about 120 million cubic meters, and that's good size. The Grand Canyon can hold about 4.7 trillion cubic meters. That'd be a big one. But we can chalk this one up to a strong maybe. Like so many theories we settle on, though, there's no real way to test this out. We've got no other confirmed examples to show they can reach these sizes. So now I hope you'll entertain what I think is a more modern solution to the question of how the Grand Canyon was formed. This time we're not only using earthly evidence, but also data returned by space probes and produced by more than a century of experimental and theoretical work in plasma laboratories. To start with, consider that the Grand Canyon is often compared to, in form if not size, the gigantic scar across Mars' surface, Valles Marineris. These structures are so similar that experts originally assumed the Mars canyons must have been formed by massive water erosion at some earlier, supposedly wetter epoch in Martian history. After all, that's how they thought Earth's Grand Canyon was formed. A nice theory, but the missing water erosion and ponding blew it out of the water some years back. The current favored explanation is that the surface of Mars must have opened up with a giant tectonic rift like the East African Rift Valley. Trouble is, rifting is usually accompanied by volcanic activity due to increased heat flow from the interior. But there's no major volcanic features around Valles Marineris, so that one's out too. Then there's the multitude of short but deep tributary canyons branching off at sharp angles to the main canyon. Now, the experts claim that underground water could undercut these tributaries, but the lack of collateral damage to the surface on both Mars and Earth looked more like these canyons were cut cleanly into a raised, flat surface. I agree with the original sentiment that the similarities of these canyons makes a strong argument for similar formations. And as usual, they just left one thing out. We live in an electrically charged universe, and the interplanetary lightning our ancestors witnessed was enough to scare the fear of Armageddon into them, the thunderbolts of the gods. Proponents of the electric universe model suggest that massive electric arcs are responsible for not only our Grand Canyon and Valles Marineris, but also to the Martian scars twin found on Venus. To make this point, let's look at the heart of geology and planetary studies, a process of reasoning called abduction. It's a form of logic where the major premise is certain and the minor premise is probable. Example, if the major premise is all sinuous channels are formed by flowing liquid, and the minor premise is Nurgle Valles on Mars is a sinuous channel, that means that Nurgle Valles was formed by flowing liquid. Makes sense, I guess. But what if the major premise was garbage to begin with? First law of computing. Garbage in equals garbage out. Mars is a desert planet with no possibility of flowing liquid, and it's been that way for a very long time, as far as we can tell. Those huge channels cut into the surface look like they were formed yesterday. And that kind of torpedoes the major premise, doesn't it? Remarkably, these channels convince the experts that there must have been said flowing liquids in the recent past, because the idea that their major premise was wrong had never occurred to anyone. NASA's Mars Reconnaissance Orbiter, MRO, sent back some more backup for the standard model when their spectral scans detected signatures of hydrated minerals on slopes where mysterious streaks were seen. They seemed to ebb and flow down the slopes in the warmer season, and then fade in the cooler seasons, according to NASA. Now, is that evidence for water? I don't know, maybe. But is it evidence for the kind of flowing liquid that carves out a canyon 10 times the size of the Grand Canyon? Well, call me skeptical, I guess. Now, if we drop the major premise and pencil in the electric force, things make a little more sense to me. These sinuous channels are usually called rills on Mars, Venus, and the Moon. And no one in their right mind is going to suggest these things are formed by flowing water on the Moon or Venus. So instead, they claim lava did it. Well, that's weird, though, because lava would have needed to remain liquid over hundreds, in some cases thousands of miles. Because of this, the experts decided there must have been a rock roof over the top of them that would later collapse, magically, without any rubble. Oh, and some of them would have had to have been over a mile wide. There's rills on the Moon and Venus that are wider than the longest lava tubes on Earth. Not only is there no rubble, the sides of the rills are cleanly chiseled in the surface. Considering no lava has flowed on Venus for millions of years, and billions on the Moon, seems a little weird that there's no erosion of any kind. But check out Schroeder's Valley on the Moon. Thing looks like it got scooped out last week. Clean-cut sides, sharp angles, filamentary structure. And even if the lava was shot out of Lee Harvey Oswald's squirt gun, it's still not making those turns. More importantly, though, unlike water, lava doesn't just seep into the ground and vanish. No lava outflows means lava did not do this. Then, just like with the Colorado, the experts don't seem to have a problem with the outflow into the supposed river being higher in elevation than the narrow source. I don't think lava flows uphill either. Here's a quick list of other oddities. Many of these riverbeds run parallel to one another. Some have circular craters along their lengths, while others downright look like crater chains or lines of deep pits, and most of them terminate on a crater. All of these craters, of course, are at direct 90-degree angles from the surface, and many contain smaller craters inside of them. For fun, here's some more abduction with a flawed major premise. Craters are caused by meteor strikes. Meteor strikes occur over time. Therefore, the Moon is billions of years old because it's covered in craters. A piece of sheet metal I had machined last week is covered in trillions of microscopic craters. Therefore, my sheet metal is billions of years old and has been getting bombarded by meteors the entire time. Or maybe we've had the answer for 30 years. I don't mean some untestable theoretical gobbledygook. I mean actual hard science done with rigorous experimentation by the brilliant electrical engineer Ralph Jurgens of Flagstaff, Arizona. In a series of papers that would not be published in a mainstream scientific journal, he showed that flowing liquids are completely unnecessary to explain all these river-like channels on planets and moons. He showed how the strange features of these channels could simply be scaled down and matched against the kind of damage caused by lightning strikes on Earth. So even if Mars had surface moisture in the past, its vast channels were not carved by rushing water. Here's a couple of examples of powerful lightning strikes. This one's at Baker, Florida, 1949. The thing killed 3 players and injured 50 others. If you look close at the trench it tore out of the ground, you can see the more sinuous path the actual arc followed. And check out this lightning strike on a golf course. It almost looks like a topo map of the Grand Canyon, having many of the same jagged filamentary rills and channels. That's only a small lightning scar. Valles Marineris is huge. Very true, but one thing that electrical engineers figured out a long time ago. Electrical phenomenon scales perfectly. From the quantum to the galactic, high-energy electrical experiments show that the same patterns of behavior can be scaled up to over 100 million times. One simple process at work throughout the universe, easy to understand, easy and inexpensive to test and confirm. Truth is, plasma cosmologists can do controlled scaled experiments on Earth to answer puzzles that have been plaguing planetologists for decades. Valles Marineris is an electrical arc scar. It bears the hallmarks writ large on the planet's surface. We understand the electric force so well we've turned it into a utility. We see its signature everywhere in space. Watch its braided filaments cross the cosmos. Its handwriting is all over the Grand Canyon and its Martian and Venusian counterparts. Telltale signs all over the planets and moons. In a reality that's made of energy, doesn't it just make sense that there's one force that governs it all?